Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good to see some fabulous new faces and familiar faces, and the way the sun is shining in our presence, even if it is a bit grim or gloomy outside. We want you to know that no matter where you are on life's journey, and no matter who you happen to be, you are very welcome here. We know that in this time and place, God is present. God's Spirit is moving among us. And whether you're joining us here in person or those who may be joining us online, we're just so thrilled that you have chosen to share of your time in order to receive God's goodness as we worship God together. Now, there's something we love to affirm whenever we get together, and that's God's goodness. So let's do it. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
And because you can't affirm that too much, you got to do it again. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Amen and amen. We trust that you are going to receive the inspiration you need today to feed and nourish you throughout the rest of your week. And now I'm going to invite our own Deacon Paul to lead us in the responsive call to worship you'll find printed in your bulletin and also on the screen.
God's breath of hope into despair of a situation, lifting our burdens and giving the strength for a new beginning.
We remember, praise God who gives us life.
When the Israelites ran out of food to eat, God provided them the bread in the morning and the meat in the evening.
We remember, praise God who satisfies our hunger.
God always makes a way when there seems to be none.
We remember, praise God who shows us what is possible and sets us free.
Let us worship God. In your black hymnals, we will be singing Great is Thy Faithfulness, 4, 2, 3, and the black hymnals. Please join us and rise if you may, if you are able.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer confession in unison, that is in your bulletin as well. God of the amazing grace,
so many stories
in scripture remind us that you bless us with what we need to thrive, yet so often fail to appreciate all that you provide. Our fear of scarcity drives us to acquire what we don't need, hoard what we could share, and envy what we don't have. We can find ourselves in a wilderness full of discouragement about present circumstances, nostalgia for the good old days, and resistance to change. We struggle to trust in your care. We may doubt that the new life you invite us to experience could be better than the life we have known. Come, God, and move within our hearts. Transform us and set us free. Beloved people of God, hear this glorious good news. God does not operate according to our understanding of what is fair or appropriate. God is extravagantly generous, offering us an abundance of forgiveness, compassion, and love. Let your hearts stand open to God's grace, which is so full of bounty. May it transform you and liberate you from all that has you bound. Together, let us embark upon the joyful adventure that leads to wholeness and fullness of life.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
So our first lesson this morning comes to us from the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter 16, verses 1 through 18. And we have a variety of people who are going to be reading this morning. We're going to have Reverend Kara H. is serving as the voice of the Israelites. Mike S. is going to serve as Moses. And yours truly, Joe cast me as God. Okay. Susie is also going to assist us via Zoom as Aaron.
The whole congregation of the Israelites set out from Elim, and Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had departed from the land of Egypt. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger."
Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way, I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days.
So Moses
and Aaron
said to the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord."
"For what are we that you complain against us?"
And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening, and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining."
And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud.
God spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know I am the Lord your God." In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground.
And when the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was.
Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. This is what the Lord has commanded. Gather as much of it as each of you needs, an omer to a person according to the number of persons, all providing for those in their own tents."
So the Israelites did so, some gathering more, some less. But when they measured it with an omer, those who gathered much had nothing over, and those who gathered little had no shortage. They gathered as much as each of them needed.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Now, our second lesson comes to us from the Gospel according to Matthew, and we're going to be hearing from Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16. I forgot to mention this before, but as you'll see, those who are here in the sanctuary, in your bulletin, you can follow along in your pew Bible if you would like. It is in the Gospel of Matthew, is in the back of the pew Bible, in the section of the Bible known as the Second Testament, also sometimes called the New Testament, on page 21. Now, Josie, of course, is back in his favorite role as Jesus. Allison D is going to be the vineyard owner, the landowner, and Jim M right here is going to serve as the laborer in this wonderful and confounding story we're about to hear.
"I'm wearing a mask to hide my wrinkles, just so you know. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing in the marketplace without work, and he said to them,
'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.'
So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them,
'Why are you standing here idle all day?'
They said to him,
Because no one has hired us.
He said to them,
you also go into the vineyard.
Those last worked.
When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager,
call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.
When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now, when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the daily usual wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying,
These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.
But he replied to one of them,
friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to the last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?
So the last will be first, and the first will be last.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Now, our hymn of preparation, you'll find it in your bulletin on page 10, and the words will also be on the screen. But we're going to sing this through twice. So verse 1, verse 2, and then verse 1 and verse 2. You'll see that there are quite a few words that repeat each other. And again, kind of like a song we sang last week, this is kind of an opportunity for us to enter into a prayerful, reflective way of being because of those repeated words and the simple to sing melody. So if you are able, we invite you to rise to join in singing Come and Fill. Please be seated. There's something challenging about trying to experience the world in a new way, trying to have our preconceived notions broken open. Sometimes we have an awful lot of resistance to that. Well, 1 month after their dramatic departure from being enslaved in Egypt, the Israelites were having some second thoughts about their newfound freedom. Sure, when Moses had first approached them with God's promise to break the yoke of their oppressors, they were thrilled.
No more brutal overseers with their fond use of the whip. No more never-ending, mind-numbing, back-breaking labor. No more children crying themselves to sleep at night and growing old and bent long before their time. No more being treated like livestock or worse, their value derived only from how many bricks they could produce. Moses had kindled the fires of hope in their eyes and their hearts. They were eager to experience a life in which they could finally make their own choices. But following their amazing, extraordinary escape from their captors, the Israelites head out into a rather harsh landscape, only to encounter a variety of daunting challenges. And you see, about a month to 6 weeks after they had first left Egypt, they start to question the wisdom of doing so. They're getting a little discouraged because they're not getting anywhere. They're getting very worried because they're running out of the supplies that they had packed to bring with them, and they're growing very hungry. Now, if Snickers commercials can talk about how people get hangry, I think you can imagine what these Israelites were experiencing. They're pretty concerned, and somehow they have forgotten the extraordinariness of their escape. So they start complaining. My gosh, what are we doing all the way out here in this harsh, barren landscape? We got nothing to eat. Oh, but now let's think back fondly to days before, conveniently forgetting the stuff that wasn't so great about those days before, but remembering that, oh, you know what? Those enslavers, surely they weren't that bad because at least they provide us with something to eat. And in fact, they even have perhaps a rather rosy colored look back into the past because they talk about having flesh pots, giant stew pots of meat, which may or may not have been their actual experience. But how many times when we're in a new situation, is it so easy to look back to what used to be and think that, oh man, all was just awesome back then? That's the problem with nostalgia. Feeling the harsh heat of the sun, their stomachs growling, they complain rather bitterly. This is in the section of the Bible that's kind of come to be known as the murmuring section, because we get to hear how the Israelites have a variety of murmurings of discontent at various times. But in any case, something amazing happens. The same God who had found a way to set them free in the story doesn't get cranky with them being cranky. No, instead, God decides to provide for their needs. Before Moses even says something to God. I think that's kind of awesome because Moses in turn is getting cranky with the people being cranky, but God is not getting cranky. God is busy going about making a way where there seems to be none, providing food for the people in the middle of nowhere. And what I find so extraordinary about this story is the fact that there is enough for everyone. Yes, everybody is invited to go out and collect the manna, which, by the way, that's kind of a play on the word, the Hebrew words for what is it? And I don't know about you, but I have a feeling that that's kind of a cleaned up version of what is it? What the bleep is it? Would have been more likely for the people. But in any case, here they are. They're going out, they're invited to gather. But if they are a collection of people, like most collections of people, not everybody is gonna be equally focused on the task of gathering the manna.
Some people may get easily distracted, not by a squirrel, because as far as I know, they don't have squirrels in the desert, but maybe something else, right? Maybe a scorpion, I don't know. But in any case, there are going to be people who are very diligent about the task, and there are going to be other people that, you know, we'll grab a little bit here, maybe a little there. And the amazing thing is, despite this variety of focus, the variety of ability even, and gathering this manna, everybody still ends up with enough. Now, you might have missed it, but in this story, you're not supposed to worry about whether or not there's going to be manna tomorrow. In fact, when they are supposed to take a Sabbath day of rest, God's going to make sure that their collection baskets have enough for 2 days and it won't spoil. But if they do hold on to it, they don't eat it up in the one day, if they lose track that this is their daily bread that God is providing, if they fail to trust that more will be forthcoming the next day, guess what? It rots. What a powerful, powerful story about God ensuring that everybody has enough. Nobody can hoard, because if they do, it's just going to rot. And nobody is going to not have enough, no matter what. But of course, some of them try to create a bit of manna insurance, banking up some extra to protect themselves against future threat of hunger. Because after all, we're in the middle of nowhere. How are we supposed to rely on God to keep providing this? And yet, we're not so different from our Israelite forebears in the faith. Whether the story is absolutely true and accurate, that doesn't matter. The point is what the story is revealing to us about how God hears the people when they're hungry and ensures that everybody has enough. That's God's economy. Goodness knows our capitalist economy may not function that way, but that's how God functions. That's what the story is trying to teach us. We may not need to produce a certain quota of bricks every day, 7 days a week, but we frequently may feel driven to work long hours without adequate rest to put bread on the table. We too struggle to trust that we're going to have enough. And we frequently try to store up more money, more stuff, heck, even more food. How many of you have been horrified to discover when you were cleaning out your pantry, your cupboard, your whatever, and discover that, oh my gosh, some of that pasta that we saved because it was on sale, it's gone bad. Or the pasta sauce, or any number of other things, right? See? How often do we give our allegiance to the pharaohs of the world that tell us, well, the system may be broken, but God and we are powerless to change it, and we're foolish to think otherwise. And yet that isn't how God operates, and that's not the kind of world that God wants to see us experience. We are tempted, though, sometimes to struggle not to look back in the past and to get caught up in what we think is fair. Okay, how many of you, when you were a kid, would be the first one to be able to point out when something was not fair? Okay, yeah, we are hardwired to notice what is fair. They've even done research on this. I can't think of the name of the type of specialty, but with a variety of different kinds of primates to discover that, yeah, even our primate cousins, they will object profusely when they feel that something is not fair. Now, the good thing about whether something or not is fair and how we notice this is that it helps us potentially to address some of the wrongs that might be present, the inequalities that might be present within a society. But sometimes we also want to apply this to God. So Jesus tells us this rather strange parable that I have wrestled with like you would not believe this week. A parable of a vineyard owner who decides, I need some laborers for the harvest of the grapes. Not a surprising thing. He goes to the marketplace. Now, how many of you have ever seen a place here in Poughkeepsie or anywhere else where day laborers gather? And, you know, sometimes they're gathering first thing in the morning at daybreak, hoping against all hope that someone will come and ask them to work for them. Well, the same situation was true in Jesus' day. The trouble is, day laborers in that day, just like today, lived on the very edges of society as far as they're having enough of almost anything, because they were reliant on someone just like today to come and hire them. And although Jewish law was very specific that every day laborer should be paid at the completion of a day's work, not all employers actually followed that practice. So here we've got this group of people at daybreak in the marketplace, hoping against all hope that they will be hired so that they might just have the bare minimum to get food to eat that day, because that's what they'd be paid, a denarius. Now, some people say, oh, that was a living wage. It was not. It wasn't enough to buy food and clothing. It wasn't enough to buy food and maybe fix a broken roof. It was just barely enough to buy food. So this vineyard owner goes at dawn and finds a group of workers and agrees with them. Okay, I'm going to hire you for a denarius, the typical day laborer's wage. They go, they start working. The sun rises, gets hot and sweaty. Meanwhile, at 9 o'clock in the morning, vineyard owner goes back to the marketplace, does it again at noon, does it again at 3, and does it yet again at 5, about an hour before the sun is likely to set for the day. And each time he gets another group of laborers to come to work in the vineyard, presumably to harvest the grapes. Now, what's kind of amazing is he doesn't necessarily tell each of those subsequent group of workers what he's going to pay them. He just says, I'm going to pay you what's right. Here's the thing. In Jesus' day, it was the Roman occupiers and their wealthy sort of client people who bought up the land that was supposed to sustain the families living in Israel, Palestine, and converted them from being places where people could have, you know, the kind of kitchen gardens that would sustain a family to being vineyards. Why? Because, man, grapes make a much higher profit than all of those little subsistence farmers just getting enough for their family to get by. So the fact that this person is a wealthy landowner and can go and hire laborers whenever he chooses, this isn't necessarily meant to be a story about God, but a story that reveals something of the injustices that the people who followed Jesus, the ones at the margins, the one who had very little from day to day, that they would have understood. They knew what it was like to spend a back-breaking day in the hot sun, sweating, doing all of the work just to get enough to buy a meal. Now, what makes this story so upsetting and confounding to most of us is what happens at the end of the day. The sun starts to set, people are like, oh gosh, all right, in their sweat-stained clothes that are dirty and their exhaustion from working all day, all right, the ones who started at daybreak, they know they're going to get a denarius at least. So they line up, except that the landowner tells the manager, go to the ones who worked the least amount. Start with them and pay them. Oh, and by the way, pay them the same thing that you're going to pay the ones who were there all day. Now, if you are one of the laborers who were there from the very beginning, standing there in your sweat-soaked tunic, experiencing the dirt, the heat, the exhaustion of a very long day, how are you going to feel about seeing somebody who came and only worked about an hour getting the same thing that you had been promised? That doesn't feel fair, does it? No. And of course, they understandably object. And here's the part in the story that for me is so difficult and why I wrestled so much. Because the landowner claims not only that he's doing no wrong, but claims, am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? See, it's an anathema that the Romans own the land that should be there to provide sustenance for the people on the edge and on the margins. And how dare this landowner claim that land that was a gift to the people from God is his to do with, his resources, he can do whatever he want with them, and to claim in the translation that we have that he is generous. I mean, he's still only given the bare minimum. True, he kept going back into the marketplace to keep getting more people who had not yet been hired. And yes, he gave them the bare minimum, but it's only the bare minimum, which is why I don't necessarily see this as a parable about God, but a parable that might just point to, if even this Roman landowner could find a way to ensure people had the absolute basic of sufficient food to eat for the day, how much more generous would God be? After all, Jesus is really clear at the end of telling this story. The last will be first, and the first will be last. This story, I think, is intended to help us maybe see things in a slightly different light. We got to have that experience a little bit, those of us who participated in the online conference this week, Partners in Building, put on by the United Church of Christ Church Building and Loan Fund. And we had some very powerful speakers, and one of them said something I thought quite profound that applies to both stories we've had today. He said, this is Bishop Dwayne Royster, said, they've done some studies and they've basically discovered about human beings that after the age of 21, adults only learn from failure. You're not going to grow if you're not stretched and challenged. Went on to say, what happened for our churches pre-COVID is dead. We're in a new reality now. See, as Reverend Dr. Gregory J. Edwards, the pastor of Resurrected Life Church in Allentown, Pennsylvania, says, you got to examine the story that keeps you hostage. What was the story that kept the Israelites hostage, even after those chains had been bound? It was the story of not having enough. Examine the story that keeps you hostage, the already self-defeating deficit mindset that makes you think you aren't enough, you don't have enough, You're not going to be able to make a difference. Your church might fall apart because we're in this new era and the rise of the N-O-N-E-S's, the nuns, people who are not religiously affiliated, is so much higher, and oh my gosh, everything might fall apart. But yet, when we trust the God who always provides what we need, when we have hope that the future is something where God already is, then we start looking for opportunities here and now to make a difference. We start to trust that God will always find a way when it seems like there's nothing but obstacles before us. We can dream a new dream together. We can, instead of looking back in our own lives or in the life of this congregation to what used to be, and instead look forward to what can be. Instead, to dream big dreams and to trust God is always going to be with us. God's got us. In our own lives, in the life of this congregation, yes, even in our world that's so mixed up, that's so full of hurt and suffering, of violence and injustice, God's got us. And God is at work for the good in even the most impossible situations. So I invite all of you, maybe, just maybe, we need to try a new thing in your own life without being so afraid of failure, without being so caught up in what used to be that we don't risk something amazing. Because maybe, just maybe, we'll only learn by trying and having it not work. And maybe, just maybe, when we try, because God is with us, we might also succeed beyond our wildest imaginings. Maybe, just maybe, all of us this week needs to ask ourselves, what's the story that keeps each of us hostage? What's the already self-defeating mindset that convinces us you're not enough, you don't have enough, the world is a horrible, awful place, and instead say, the world is where God is. God will meet us exactly where we are. God won't condemn us for feeling discouraged or frustrated, just like God didn't condemn those Israelites. No, God found a way to meet their need. Same for us. Thanks be to God for always making a way, no matter the circumstances. Amen. In our prayers this morning, we'll have an opportunity for those who are joining us online to voice their joys and concerns, as well as those here in the sanctuary. The folks in the sanctuary will invite you to use a microphone. Did I forget something? Yes, I forgot something. We have a fabulous song response. When I go out of my own routine, I sometimes forget things. We will take what you offer. We are going to be singing this through a couple of times. Again, it's kind of a prayerful kind of song. So let's join in singing it. Thank you.
Please be seated.
I invite you now to be with me in a spirit of prayer. God, you are ever present. You always hear our cries, and you are always faithful in responding to our needs. We pray for our country and the global community, who so often are ruled by Pharaoh economics rather than manna economics. We ask that your spirit might be at work in our leaders' decisions, that they may be guided with the concern of people's well-being more than of profits, with the idea of serving others, not themselves. God, in your mercy. We pray for our local community, for kids and their teachers as they seek to learn at the start of a new school year, for families that may be experiencing the devastation of poverty, of domestic violence, of the struggle to feel like tomorrow could be a good day. We pray for our emergency workers, particularly those who fight fires and those who do their best to save lives. May they not grow weary in their work. God, in your mercy. We pray for all who are struggling with illness, with sorrow and loss, with grief or anxiety, with depression, with addiction, with loneliness. We pray for Karen C., mourning the loss of her aunt. We pray for Joe D., recovering from surgery, for Jean C., who is back in the hospital, in need of being stabilized. Help her not to grow discouraged. We pray for Ha T., with thanksgiving that she's been healed of pneumonia, but also with concern for new health complications, that you would be powerfully at work in her body as well. And for Pat W., for Mary B.'s friend Andrew L., for Peg T. and Kathleen G., for Alan C. and his family, for Susie's friends Brian and Andrew, for all of those who are experiencing the devastating war in Ukraine, and for those who are refugees from it. We particularly hold up Vitalia, Sasha, Evelina, and Adelina D. For Bob M. and Mike S. For Betty A. C. and Don L. and Scott B. God, in your mercy. And now I invite our Deacon Paul. He will come to those of you who are seated in the sanctuary with a microphone. If you have a joy or concern you'd like to raise up for us to include in our prayers, please share those now. Well, I'd like to invite those who are joining us on Zoom, if you have any joys or concerns to share, to please unmute your microphone and share them with us now. God, it is true that sometimes we forget. Your power working within us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Help us when we're feeling down or discouraged, frustrated, alone. Help us to remember that this is true. And help us to find new insight and fresh wisdom and guidance in those very familiar words that Jesus taught us to pray together. Our Father, our Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen. Sometimes it takes practice to trust in God's generosity to us. I know I've had to learn that and practice it a lot. But fortunately for us, whenever we gather to worship, we have an opportunity to practice that trusting in God whenever we share what it is that we value, our knowledge, our time, our skill, and yes, our treasure. When we share what we value, we acknowledge that it's not a finite, never to be replenished resource, that God who provides will continue to provide. And so we are enough and we have enough to make a difference. And it's through our sharing that we not only support the ministries of this church, but we help to change the world around us, to make it more loving, to make it kinder and gentler, and maybe, just maybe, to introduce a bit of God's manna economics to a world hungry for something different. Our morning tithes and offerings to God will now be received. Thank you.
you please join with me in the unison prayer of dedication found in your bulletin on page 4, or of course you can also follow along on the screen. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we return to you a portion of all that you have given us. May our sharing reflect the generosity you have shown us. We dedicate these offerings to your work, that they may become a fruitful blessing to this church, our community, and our world. Call us all into the vineyard of meaningful labor and restorative rest, that we might be instruments of your economy of grace. Show us how to use all that we are and all that we have to build your kingdom, which welcomes all, loves all, needs all, and serves all. We pray in the name of Jesus, who satisfies our deepest hunger and sets us free. Amen. Please be seated. I'm going to try and take you through the announcements just as speedily as possible. So the first announcement, which we will have in just a moment, because I don't remember what I put in first. I think it's about the Inquirers class. Is it just frozen on you? There we go. Yes, we have an Inquirers class today. This is very fun. People who just want to learn a little bit more about our church, there is no obligation in coming to our Inquirers class to actually become a member of the church. But if you have any curiosity about what church membership is about, you would want to come to Inquirers class. If you just want to know a little bit more about who we are and what we do in the community and what the United Church of Christ is all about, we sure hope you'll join us for that too. Here's the thing, the timing of it is 12:15, so everybody can go and get some delicious food, of which we have quite a bit at our fellowship hour meal today, and then we'll go and meet in Swart's Parlor. And if you say, I have no clue where the heck that is, fear not, we'll help you get there. Next slide. So our sizzling summer fun drive, we were supposed to do the drawing last week, but that just didn't end up happening for a variety of reasons. It kind of fell apart, but we are going to do it today during fellowship hour. So hopefully everybody has who participated in that wrote down the numbers of the envelopes that they took down from the bulletin board once upon a time. And if you don't remember, well, this is your opportunity to look in your checkbook or wherever to see if you can find that information. But we'll do that during fellowship hour. Reverend Chris, I have to get the stuff out of my office, but we will. Okay, next slide. Ah, our church work day. Yes, we weren't sure last Sunday when that's happening. It is happening this coming Saturday from 9 to noon. I'm just going to say the coffee and cider donuts are going to show up because they have in the past. So let's just imagine that that's going to take place. I'm sure the trustees will provide. There are all kinds of simple jobs that you can do to make a difference. And there is a great sense of community that arises from all of us doing these tasks that help out. We're doing this in preparation for what I hope is the next slide. Yes, the Hudson Valley Gospel Festival. We are so excited that we get to be the hosts of this. That's happening later that day from 7 to 9 p.m. And the tickets are $20 for like general admission, $15 if you're a student, if you are a veteran, if you are active military. Senior, if you're a senior. Yes, woo, how could I forget that? So that's the story with that. You can get tickets at the door. You can also go to artsmidhudson.org, I believe is the website. Yes, and get tickets there. Oh, you got that. Okay, very good. Thank you, Reverend Kara. Appreciate that. So see Reverend Kara once more with a hand raised. There she is. Okay, excellent. Can you flip back to the slide for just a moment? So the other thing is we need some help preparing some refreshments because we want to have a simple reception for folks as an expression of our hospitality to all these people. I mean, it could be as many as 200 to 300 people that come outside of our congregation to this. Because the choir and the musicians and so forth, they draw from a wide variety of congregations themselves. So that being the case, if you can help out in any way, be in touch with Deb Booker. Her information is in the bulletin. You can bring homemade cookies. You can bring cheese and crackers. You could bring veggies and dip. You know, if we're going to have 200 to 300 people, like, let's really show out the welcome, right? Okay, next slide.
This is just giving you a roundup of all the different things happening this week. Board of Trustees had to be rescheduled to this coming Tuesday at 6:30 on Zoom. We're also going to have the church council on Thursday at 7 p.m. My pastor's virtual office hour may have to be canceled because I may be needed to help with a family medical matter. So if that's the case, don't be surprised if I'm not there online on Zoom from noon to one on Thursday. But in any case, you can see that's through Friday what's happening. And then we have another slide for Saturday and Sunday. And Sunday, of course, is World Communion Sunday, which is really fun. This is the one time a year that we offer communion with both grape juice and wine, okay? Because it's in recognition that the wider community of the body of Christ, in many traditions, people only serve wine for communion. So we do that in honor of all of those folks around the world. So next slide. Here's some awesome stuff that's happening in October. More information is printed in your bulletin, but we got a lot going on. And you say, what the heck is HVH? That's Hudson Valley Hospice. They're having an adult bereavement group that's going to be here. They request that you do reach out to them to indicate your interest so they have a sense of how many people to prepare for. Information is in your bulletin and in the e-news about that. Also, crop walk, yard sale fundraiser, and a fabulous book group discussing. And we have a couple extra copies here in case anybody was having difficulty getting their hands on one. The book, Have You Seen Louis Velez? So if that's something you want to be part of, it's a great book. Lots more information in your bulletin in the e-news. Okay, I think that was the last announcement slide. Am I right, Reverend Chris? Are there any other announcements that anybody might have? Awesome sauce. Okay, let us continue then. In that case, we're going to move on to our closing hymn. Now we're going to be singing What a Covenant. Now, What a Covenant was originally kind of written in very square 4/4, very, forgive me, but very white Protestant way. And we're going to jazz it up a little bit here. So have a good time singing this hymn. And if you're able, get on up and feel free to dance a little too. A covenant, what hope, joy divine, lead me on the everlasting waters. What hope, blessedness, what hope, peace is mine, lead me on the everlasting waters. Thank you. I was having such a good time singing and dancing, I'm a little out of breath. Woo. Beloved people of God, hear this wonderful good news. God provides. God's got you. And no matter where your journey takes you this week, God is beside you. God will help you through whatever challenges you face. Trust that there is a way to be in this world that is full of hope rather than fear. Trust that God will show you a way, especially when it seems like all the doors have closed. And above all, trust that the blessing of the earth maker and the pain bearer and the life giver go with you today and always. Amen.